Lord, just be a help to people and a blessing. Lord, help us that we can glorify thy precious name. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to preach tonight on the subject, Joseph shall have two portions. You know, from Ezekiel chapter 40 through 48, there's a description of the new temple, the temple that will be built in the thousand-year reign of our Lord Jesus Christ. And there is also a description of the division of the land that each of the tribes of the children of Israel will inherit during that period of time. It seems that each tribe will receive, kind of unlike it was in Joshua's days, but each tribe will receive the same portion of land. And it's here that we find this statement, Joseph shall have two portions. So we understand that Joseph received two portions because of two reasons. First of all, his older brother Reuben, Jacob's firstborn, had sinned. He had sinned with his father's concubine, and therefore, because he did that, he forfeited his right, his blessing to the birthright. And second, Joseph was a faithful servant of the Lord. He lived a holy life. And because Joseph was a godly man and was a great blessing to his family, Jacob gave him this blessing, and God directed that he would receive a double blessing. Because Joseph was faithful to the Lord and lived a holy life, we see how the Lord blessed him, and he blessed him in three ways. First of all, the Lord was with Joseph through his troubles. What a great thing. The second thing is the Lord used Joseph to bless his family. What a great thing. And the Lord will bless Joseph in the kingdom age. What great blessings the Father has for not just Joseph, but for all of those who give their life to him and follow him and live faithfully and live holy lives for him. God has great blessings, not only in this life, but in the world to come. How sad that so many today cannot see the tragedy of life without God. And not only the tragedy of life of sin, but the tragedy of life of worldliness and without the holiness of God in their life. It's like the rich man who decided, that Jesus told us about, who decided to tear down his barns and build bigger barns. They spend their life on, first of all, that which cannot satisfy. You know, people who don't have Jesus can never be satisfied. I believe that. I believe the only way that you can be satisfied in this life is to have Jesus in your life. Secondly, they and their offspring suffer the consequences of sin. I believe people who live for the Lord are a blessing, not only to themselves, but to their offspring and to their families and to others. And I believe that people who reject the Lord Jesus Christ bring all kinds of trouble upon themselves, and not only upon themselves, but their offspring and others. And they doom themselves to eternal damnation in the lake of fire. I hope tonight that everybody in this house is saved. Now, I would like to see more people come. I'd like to see people who are not saved come to the house of God, because my hope is they'll get saved. But if you're not saved tonight, I hope the things that I present to you tonight will make you think about your soul and cause you to want to be saved. Because let me tell you, there's nothing better in this life than knowing the Lord Jesus Christ. And there's nothing better in the next life than knowing the Lord Jesus Christ. How important it is to know Jesus tonight. I hope you know him. First of all, the Lord was with Joseph through his troubles. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 10 says, "But the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, settle you." That's quite a verse. And the Apostle Peter spoke a truth here that applies not only to Joseph in the Old Testament, but applies to all of God's people today. It is, as I said a moment ago, it applies to all the people who have ever followed the Lord and whoever will follow the Lord. You know, Joseph's life, I think, is a very good example of this. Joseph believed in the Lord. He was blessed. He had a good life. Joseph was a godly young man who loved the Lord, and God gave him visions, and he was close to the Lord. I believe that's the way it ought to be for every young person. My son, give me thine heart, the scripture says. God knows that if young people will get saved, really saved, not the kind of salvation that some people have today, a think-so salvation, not the kind of salvation that people talk about today that just makes you religious, but I'm talking about giving your heart to the Lord, loving the Lord, surrendering your heart to the Lord, having the Holy Spirit in your heart. My friend, if you will do that, young people, let me tell you, if you will do that, you will have a good life. God will bless you. And God will guide you around so many pitfalls and so many troubles if you will just give your heart and your life to the Lord. I didn't say it'll be easy. I didn't say that your life will be without some troubles or without some problems that I preach about this morning. The devil will always try to cause you trouble. But you see, God will guide you around so many troubles in life. Joseph believed in the Lord. He was blessed. He had a good life. Then he had to go through 13 years of trouble. He was about 17 years old, the Bible tells us, when he was put in a pit by his brothers, taken over to Egypt. And in Egypt, he went to prison, and he spent years in prison over there before he was raised up and before he became the right-hand man of Pharaoh. So he had a lot of trouble in his life. And he suffered and became, he became Pharaoh's right-hand man. Did you hear what Peter said in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 10? But the God of all grace, aren't you glad for grace? Grace is unmerited favor. God loves us. God cares about us. We don't deserve it. We're sinners. We were all a sheep going astray. We were not righteous people. We didn't seek the Lord. The Lord came seeking us. That's grace. God saved us. That's grace. Don't you just praise the Lord tonight that God loves you? You know, I think we ought to just stop and think about that sometimes and just contemplate that and meditate upon that. But he said, but the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while. Now, Peter was looking at persecution that was coming in the Roman Empire. The Christians he was speaking to were already going through persecution. And he was saying to them, the Christian life is the greatest life that you can live, but Satan will cause you to be persecuted sometimes. And you're going to have to go through some trials, and you're going to have to go through some persecution, because if we love Jesus Christ, all that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. So if we're living right, Jesus said, woe unto you when all men speak well of you. If you can go along, what he was talking about there is if we're the kind of person that, you know, when we're with this crowd, we go along with them. And when we're with this crowd, we go along with them. And then when we're church crowd, we go along with them. And Jesus said, that's not the way to live. Jesus calls us to surrender our life to him and live for him every day, no matter the crowd that we're with. But he said, we're going to have to go through some time of trouble, some time of persecution. You see, the Lord was with Joseph, through the times of suffering. Joseph lived faithfully for the Lord. And the Lord was there strengthening him. He was in the pit. Can you imagine being in that pit? Your own family taking you and throwing you into that pit. How did Joseph stand that? I'll tell you how he stood that. He got a hold of God. He was faithful to the Lord. Here was a young man that loved the Lord. Listen, young people can do a lot for the Lord. And God can do a lot with young people's lives if they let him. Here was a young man who was thrown into a pit. While he was in that pit, I have no doubt he did a lot of praying in that pit. He loved the Lord. He went to Potiphar's house and Potiphar's wife lied about him. He was put in prison. And it was no picnic like the prisons. Not that they're a picnic, but they're a whole lot better than the kind of prison that Joseph went to down in Egypt. And so in that prison, I'm sure that he did a lot of praying and God raised him up and placed him over the prisoners there. And so all through this time, he had trouble in his life. You know, the Lord has blessings even in times of trouble. And the Lord wants to be with us. He wants to share. He wants to share our heavy load. He wants us to cast our burdens upon him, cast our care upon him, because the Bible says he careth for you. Lord, folks, let me just say something. God's grace is sufficient for whatever situation we go through. God is able to help us. There's times we're going to have to go through trouble. There's times we're going to have to suffer for him, because the Bible says, as Peter pointed out here, after you've suffered for a while, then God's going to bless us and he's going to take us to heaven and we're going to live eternally without any trouble. You know, when people are faithful to the Lord gives strength. Corrie Ten Boom lived faithfully for. I'm just blessed by her. I read something this week. She was telling, of course, she's passed on now, but I was reading about her when she was lecturing and preaching and teaching or lecturing or whatever. She suffered through the Nazi prison camps, her and her sister. But she told of a conversation she had with her father when she was a little girl. And she said, she told her father, "I don't think I can endure persecution. I don't think I'm strong enough." And her father told her a little story. He said, "When I put you on the train to go somewhere," he said, "when do I give you the money for the train? Do I give it to you a week ahead?" She said, "No." "Do I give it to you a day ahead?" "No. You give it to me just before I get on the train." He said, "That's right." And said, "If it ever comes time for you to go through persecution, God will give you the grace just before you go through it." And then she went on and she related some things that went on there in the prison camp when she was in the concentration camp. And there were some ladies there, prisoners, fellow prisoners, who asked her to give them a Bible lesson. They knew she was a Christian. They knew she had a Bible. And by the way, the Germans call the Bible the Book of Lies. Boy, it sounds like today, doesn't it? Our society is going more and more that direction. So that's what they called it. And if anyone had a Bible, they were promised that they were going to die and they were going to suffer a horrible death. But these ladies, knowing that she was a Christian, asked her if she would give them a Bible lesson. So she went and fetched her Bible, brought it out, excuse me, and she began to, because she said she really felt led to do that. And so she got her Bible and began to give them a Bible lesson. She said during the time she was speaking, I think she said she saw a shadow, but she felt a presence behind her. And one of the ladies standing in front of her mouthed to her, and let me get this name right if I can, Loney. Loney was one of the worst women guards in the prison camp. And one of the ladies who was teaching mouthed to her, "Hide your Bible. It's Loney. Hide your Bible. It's Loney. Hide your Bible. It's Loney." But she felt impressed. She felt just impressed that she had to go on and to teach this lesson, no matter what. And so she did. And when she finished, she said, "Okay, now let's sing a hymn." You see, up until now, it's only her that's in trouble, because she's got the Bible and she's teaching the lesson. But now she's brought this other group in because now they have to take a stand for Christ. She's saying to them, now then, let's sing this hymn. And they did. And so they sung this hymn. And when they finished, a voice spoke up from behind her and said, I like that, sing another one. And they sang that one. They sang many more. And when it was over, she finally got an opportunity. Nothing happened, and she had an opportunity. She went to Loney and talked to Loney about her need for Jesus Christ. That's what God can do, you see. God is with us even in trouble, even in time. Now, sometimes it doesn't turn out that way. I understand that. Sometimes we have to suffer for the Lord. She was already suffering, and God stood with her during that time. You see, Corrie Ten Boom understood that God can be with us in the deepest and darkest valley. The Lord can give us strength. Joseph was faithful to the Lord, and the Lord was with him through his troubles. You know, having faith is living a faithful life for Jesus Christ. And when we live faithfully, the Lord will be with us through our hardships. You can't shake Him. God's going to be there with you. He wants to be there. God will be with you in the hardships. God will be with us in the temptations. He wants to give us strength. Now, I tell you, it's hard to go through temptation. Because here we are, the temptation, the devil never tempts you with something you don't want. He will pick those things that you want the most. And he will hold that out in front of you and say, here it is. All you have to do is just reach out and get it. Just reach out and enjoy it. It won't hurt anything. Just go ahead and do that. God will be there. The Bible says, resist the devil and he will flee from you. But the Lord will be there to strengthen you in time of temptation. The Lord will be with us in time of persecution. I've often thought, what would I do? Boy, we've read some stories about the young girl in Columbine and recently about young people that stood up for Jesus and lost their lives. And I've often wondered, what would I do? Somebody walked up to me and pointed a gun at me and said, are you a Christian? Well, I hope I would say, absolutely. I love Jesus, amen. If they shoot me, I'll just go to heaven, amen. But you see, it's like she said, we've got to have, I can't do that on my own. I need the Lord's strength, and God will give us that strength when we need that strength if we rely upon Him. Joseph was a faithful man. He served the Lord, and God was with him in that pit. God was with him in prison. God was with him through all of his troubles. Secondly, the Lord used Joseph to bless his family. Let me read verses 18 through 21 in Genesis chapter 50. And his brethren also went and fell down before his face, and they said, behold, we be thy servants. And Joseph said unto them, fear not, for I am in the place of, Joseph said unto them, fear not, for am I in the place of God? But as for you, ye thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good, to bring to pass as it is this day to save much people alive. Now therefore, fear ye not, I will nourish you and your little ones. And he comforted them and spake kindly unto them. Excuse me. I'll be glad this weather changes. You see, now this was after Jacob died. And the other 10 sons were afraid, not counting Benjamin. And they talked among themselves. They knew they had done a terrible thing here. They had sold their brother. Well, I don't know how you can do much worse than that. They didn't know. They thought they might have killed him. You remember? They thought he was dead. I don't know how you can live with that on your conscience. But they had. They hated him. And they sold him. Until they went over into Egypt and through that chain of events found out that he was the right-hand man to Pharaoh and he was still alive. And then once Jacob died, they thought, boy, he just withheld his hand of wrath until our father's gone. Now we've got to go to him and apologize to him. We've got to do whatever it takes to survive. And so they went to Joseph and they said, oh, we're so sorry. We're so sorry. Our father said this. We're so sorry. And Joseph said, wait a minute. I know that you meant this for evil,
but God meant it for good. Because I found the hand of God with me every step of the way. That's what I want. If God's with you, you can make it. If God's on your side, you can win. And what we need to do is just surrender our life to the Lord. And let God take control of our life and let Him direct our steps and let Him bless us and take care of us. You see, because Joseph lived for the Lord, God was able to use him to save his people. He saved his entire family. You live for Jesus, God will do great things for you. He'll use you. He'll use you in great ways. You see, because Joseph pleased the Lord, Jacob adopted Ephraim and Manasseh. It should be Manasseh and Ephraim, but because Manasseh was the oldest. And you remember whenever Joseph took his two sons to Jacob, and Jacob was going to bless them, instead of putting his hand out and putting his right hand on Manasseh and his left hand on Ephraim, he crossed his hands. Remember that? And Joseph lifted up his hands. Because that wasn't the right order. And the birthright for the oldest one in Israel, well, it was a big thing. Well, I think Jacob probably remembered his own situation. But he crossed his hands. And he gave the main blessing to Ephraim. But in that, he adopted Joseph's two sons. He said, you know, your sons now become my sons. In other words, I'm adopting them into my family. And they are going to receive, each one of them, a portion when you go into the promised land. You are going to receive a double portion when you go in, when the nation of Israel goes into the land of Canaan. One of the great benefits to serving the Lord is to be a blessing to our own family. Joseph's life came out right there. Let me tell you something, dads. You may not see what you want to see in this life. But if you will be a dad for God, He will use you to strengthen and bless your home and bless your family. And it will come out in your children. Amen? Yeah. Let me tell you something, moms. You be a mother. The pressure in this society is to try to push you out of the home and you're the greatest teacher in the world. God has given you the opportunity to live a godly life in front of your children and to teach your children and to be a blessing to your children. And it may not be a glorious thing to the world, and the world may not think very much of it, in fact. But let me tell you, God has His hand. If you're living for the Lord and you're surrendering to the Lord and living holy for the Lord, God will put His hand on you. And He will bless you. You see, we can be a great blessing. Joseph, because of Joseph, Ephraim and Manasseh both received an inheritance in the land of Canaan. And in that way, Joseph got a double portion. He got two portions of the land of Canaan. You know, my mother was a Christian. She lived for the Lord. She was kicked out of her home at age 14 by her stepfather. She went to Carthage, Illinois, 14 years old, on her own. And I don't know how she got by. I think she stayed with a family there, but somehow she got started to a church there. And she got saved. Praise the Lord. She went back, and during that period of time, and didn't get to move back in with her mom, but she got her mom in church. She married my father, who at that time was not a Christian. She took me to church, and I got saved and became a preacher.
Judy and I have 3 children who are saved and 4 grandchildren. 2 are saved and 2 are going to get saved. I know so because of their parents. Amen? And God has made that promise. Believe upon the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved and thy house. She made a deal with my brother. He was older than I was and kind of followed in my father's footsteps and wasn't a Christian. Came to the place at one point he didn't even know if there was a God. But when they came back from Illinois to farm in Missouri, she made a deal. If you're going to farm, you're going to go to church. I want you in church. And they did for a time. My dad, just before he died, got saved. Wasn't too long after that, my sister-in-law got saved. My brother's wife. And you know what she did? She went directly home and went to work on my brother, who didn't know if there even was a God. But she just kept witnessing to him and praying for him every day. And he got saved. He has 3 children. They're all in church. I trust they're saved. I don't know how many grandchildren they've got. Do you remember how many? No, a bunch. And as far as I know, every one of those kids have given their heart to the Lord. There was a young man, my nephew's son, who was a real problem growing up. Continued, got married to a Christian girl at a Christian school. When they'd gone to a Christian school together, and they got married. He was a problem, and continued to be a problem for a long time. If I'm not mistaken, last year, or the year before, I don't know which, because we didn't know what to do with him. He got saved. His children, you know, because one woman kicked out of her home at 14 years old, went to church and got saved. Believe upon the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved and thine house. Amen. God was with her and God blessed her and she became a blessing to her whole family. My friend, let me tell you something. You know, when Joseph was living a Christian life, he didn't realize that God was going to give him a double portion in the land of Canaan and God was going to bless him and make him a blessing to his entire household. You can be that if you'll turn your life over to the Lord. You see what great things, you know, I saw one time, I didn't bring that tonight, but I saw one time the family of an unsaved person. And it went down through there and it told the children, and just the opposite had taken place. It talked about the kids being in jail. It talked about the kids having all kinds of trouble in their family. It talked about all the sad things that happened to their life. Let me tell you, you turn your life over to the devil. You turn your life over to sin. You reject the Lord Jesus Christ and the devil will do just as bad to you as God will do good. A lot of people don't understand that today. The third thing, the Lord will bless Joseph with 2 portions in the kingdom age. Ezekiel chapter 47, verse 13. Thus saith the Lord God, this shall be the border whereby ye shall inherit the land according to the 12 tribes of Israel. Joseph shall have 2 portions. You know, the Lord blessed Joseph because Joseph believed in him. That's all it takes. Faith, say this with me, is being totally convinced. Faith is being totally convinced. Let's say that one more time. Faith is being totally convinced. One more time. Faith is being totally convinced. Next time I ask you that in Sunday school, I want you to know it. You see, Joseph, as a young man, believed
in the Lord. He was totally convinced that God is God. I'm totally convinced tonight that Jesus Christ is God. Amen? I'm totally convinced of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. God revealed, one God revealed in three persons, but they're all one. God is God. Jesus is God. And all that the devil could do, throwing Joseph in that pit, his family hating him, sending him over and Potiphar's wife lying about him, throwing him in that awful prison, him having to suffer as he did, all that the devil could do could not change his mind because he believed. Do you believe in the Lord tonight? Are you totally convinced that Jesus Christ is God? If so, you'll give your life to Him. And if we don't do that, we're not totally convinced. We don't have the real faith that the Bible's talking about. You see, when the Bible talks about faith, and when the Bible talks about, you know, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. He didn't say whosoever came to the altar. Now, that's good to come to the altar. He didn't say whosoever goes to church. Now, it's good to be in church. He didn't say whosoever is baptized. I've seen people, you ask them, are you saved? See, I was baptized. So I don't care when you're baptized. I want to know when you gave your heart to the Lord and the Holy Spirit came into your heart and you were born again. That's the only thing that counts. Are you born again? Because before you can be born again, you have to believe. You have to be totally convinced that Jesus Christ is God, the Son of God. And He came into the world because He had to, if we were going to be saved. There was no other way. There's no other way. There's no other name given among men whereby we must be saved. Jesus Christ is the only way. There are not two ways. There are not three ways. There's only one way, church. Don't fall for this stuff. Do you believe? Are you convinced? Are you totally convinced? Because if you're totally convinced, you live like it. Faithful. Amen? Faithful means full of faith. Say that with me. Faithful means full of faith. You see, someone who believes is totally convinced, and someone who is faithful has their life full of faith, and we're saved by grace through faith. When you're saved by grace through faith, that means you're totally believing, and you are living because you are full of faith for the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you believe? He believed. He lived a faithful, holy life. What is holy? It's purity. It's without sin. It's without stubbornness and rebellion to God. The best way I can explain holiness is to say it's being like Jesus. They were first called Christians at Antioch. Some believe that was a derogatory term. Some believe they were just referring to Christians because they lived like Jesus. No matter whether it was derogatory or whether it was just, you know, it was because they lived like Jesus. People ought to look at us and say, there's a Christian. And Joseph loved the Lord. You see, God loves us. And now he wants us to love Him. And that's the key to everything, isn't it? Jesus said, if you love me, live for me. If you love me, read my Bible. If you love me, obey me. If you love me, give your whole life to me. Because he said, if you love me, keep my commandments. Joseph walked with God. You see, the Lord blessed Joseph in many ways. He was with Joseph in all his troubles. The Lord used Joseph to be a blessing to his family. And the Lord gave Joseph two portions in the land of Canaan. But wait. Wait. The Lord isn't finished blessing. The Lord is not finished blessing Joseph today. His blessings are going on. You see, there's a prophecy here in Ezekiel 47:13. Thus saith the Lord God, this shall be the border whereby ye shall inherit the land according to the 12 tribes of Israel. Chapters 40 through 48 of Ezekiel is talking about the kingdom age. It's talking about the 1,000-year reign of Christ. We're not there yet. We still got the tribulation. And that, after Jesus comes at the second advent, he sets up his kingdom. That's the kingdom age. That's the 1,000-year millennial reign of Christ. And in that millennial reign, there's going to be a new temple for the people of Israel, for the nations of the world, actually. And the nation of Israel is going to re-inherit the land. God is going to give them that land. And the Lord says when that happens, the tribes of Israel are going to inherit the land. When that happens, Joseph is going to be blessed because his family is going to receive two portions. He's still blessing Joseph. God's blessings don't stop. And he's still going to bless Joseph in eternity because Joseph saved and he's going to be in heaven. Hallelujah. What's the devil got to compare with that? Joseph had to suffer a while. Isn't that what Peter said? Peter said, but the God of all grace, who hath called us unto this, to his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while, make you perfect. Make you perfect. That is, make you holy. That's what perfect means. Holy. Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father, which is in heaven, is perfect. Make you perfect. Establish. Strengthen. Settle you. Joseph had to suffer. Job had to suffer. The early Christians have to suffer. There's people all over the world tonight, Christian people, who are suffering. But after they suffer a while, God blesses them. Jesus said that whenever we are persecuted, we are to rejoice about it. Now that's opposite to what we think, isn't it? But do you see why he said rejoice? But he said, great is your reward. He said, great is your reward in heaven. God's blessings for those who love him, for those who don't rebel against him, those who are not stubborn against him, those who are full of faith for him, are just going to go on and on and on and on. I saw a thing. I saw a picture today. It was a soldier representing a Christian. And it looked like he'd just been through the war. He's standing there with his spear and his head down, tired and weary of the battle. And it said, God didn't promise that it would be easy, but he did promise that it would be worth it. Amen? You don't know what you're going to go through. I don't know what I'm going to go through. Some people have to fight the battle of health. I don't know why. God has a reason. I've seen sick people give a greater testimony than well people probably ever could, because they glorified the Lord out of their sickness. Some people have to fight that battle. Some people have to fight the battle like they're fighting in, Christians are fighting in Iraq and Afghanistan. They have to suffer terribly. They give up their life for Jesus. And really all the Lord asks of us right now is to be faithful. Joseph's descendants will get two portions in the millennial reign of Christ. You see, when people follow Jesus and are faithful to Him, they always triumph. Always. Turn with me, if you would, to 2 Corinthians chapter 2. Let me get over there with you. 2 Corinthians chapter 2. Listen very carefully as I read verse 14 down through verse 17. 2:14 through 17. Now thanks be unto God. I'll give you a second to get there. I want you to see this. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, beginning with verse 14. Now thanks be unto God. I still hear pages. We're getting there. Now, beginning with verse 14, chapter 2, 2 Corinthians. Now, thanks be unto God, which always, every time, always, all the way through, always is every time. Now, thanks be unto God, which always causeth us to, what's that word? Isn't that having victory? Which always causeth us to triumph in Christ and maketh manifest the savor of His knowledge by us in every place. I want you to watch this. For we are unto God a sweet savor of Christ in them that are saved and in them that perish. You see that? A sweet savor. The priests went in to the temple or the tabernacle, and they offered that sacrifice on the altar of burnt offerings. And that smoke went up. And because this offering represented this believer's consecration to the Lord smelled that, and it was a sweet savor. Your faith is precious to God. Your faithfulness, especially when it's faithfulness in the face of persecution, is precious to God. But you see what this says? It says here, For we are unto God, verse 15, for we are unto God a sweet savor of Christ in them that are saved. When we go out and we witness and we carry the word to people, and we sow that seed, and 3-4 years down the road, 10 years down the road, whatever it is, that seed sprouts, and that person gets saved. And maybe 10-15 people sowed seed, or more people sowed seed during that period of time. When you witness to somebody and they reject you, don't you think you've lost? You sowed the good seed of the Word of God, if you're using King James Bible, and the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, I know people get saved out of these modern versions, and I know it's the gospel that saves people. Amen? But you sow the good seed of the Word of God. And there, by the way, there's going to come a time people won't get saved out of modern versions because they're going to eventually take the blood out. They're going to eventually change it to where you can't get saved. Everybody's going to have a Bible that pleases them all. It's never going to offend anybody. You can't get saved if you're not offended. If your sin don't offend you, you're never going to get saved. You got to get under conviction before you can get saved. But when you give the gospel to somebody, if they get saved right then, praise God. That's wonderful. If they don't, you've sown the seed. And to the Lord, that's a sweet, just like that offering, it's a sweet smelling savor to the Lord. But preacher, I witness, and there's more people, a lot more people that don't get saved whenever I witness to them, you know. Well, look at that verse 15. For we are unto God a sweet savor of Christ in them that are saved and in them that perish. You see that? So when you take a gospel tract, you take it to the door, or you meet somebody on the street, and you offer it to them, they say, no, I don't want that. And maybe use bad language on you. Maybe do worse. I don't want that. You weakling. I don't need that. You nut. You're a menace to society. I had a man call me a pervert one time because I'm a preacher. God looks at that just as if you had taken your lamb to the altar and with all your heart given that lamb to God. Is this the best I got? And he smelled that smell and said, that is a sweet savor. Just as much as if that person got saved. The next verse tells us that exact thing. Look at verse 16. To the one we are the savor of death unto death. See, they've sealed their condemnation when they reject the gospel. And to the other, the savor of life unto life. And who is sufficient for these things? Notice verse 17. For we are not as many which corrupt the word of God, but as of God in the sight of God, speak we in Christ. That's why we stand on this book. For we are not as many who corrupt the word of God. I don't know how to get you to understand. Some of you do and some of you don't. How sacred the King James Bible is. That's another subject. You see, we can all have two portions, like Joseph. We can be blessed today. God can use us in the time of tribulation and trouble. He will be with us and He will use us. God used Joseph even in his time of tribulation. God will bless us even in this time. And I believe He gives us two portions. I don't know where it says it like that, but I'll tell you this. God gives us plenty. And He's going to bless us in eternity. Fred Craddock was a preacher. And in an address to ministers, it is said that he caught the practical implications of consecration. And he said, and I quote, "To give my life for Christ appears glorious. To pour myself out for others, to pay the ultimate price of martyrdom, I'll do it. I'm ready, Lord, to go out in a blaze of glory." End of quote. Preaching to preachers. And then he said something I thought was tremendous. And I'll just tell this in my own words. He said, we think that consecration, dedication, serving the Lord is like God giving us a $1,000 bill and saying, go to the bank and cash it. And we go to the bank, giving us a check for a $1,000 bill. $1,000. We go to the bank and we cash it. And we get a $1,000 bill and we bring it back. And we lay it all. We don't hold anything back. We lay it all on the table and say, Lord, here's all my life. Take it and use it. He said, that's the way we think of consecration. He said, that's most of the time not the way it is. He said, the Lord gives us that check. And he says, I want you to go to the bank and cash this and get nothing but quarters. Imagine $1,000 worth of quarters. And he said, I want you to take these quarters. And as you go through life, I want you to be a part of people's lives. Whoever you meet, if it's to give them the gospel, and it takes a quarter to buy a track, I want you to give them the gospel. Whoever you meet that's in a nursing home, I want you to give them a quarter in the name of Jesus. Whoever you meet that's in a prison, I want you to give them a quarter in the name of Jesus. Whoever you meet that's out on the street, I want you to give them a quarter in the name of Jesus. And we go on through life like that, giving ourselves a quarter at a time for Jesus. He said, that is consecration. You see, Joseph got two portions. That's what God was telling me when I looked at that verse, and he said, preach on that. Give yourself. You'll have to do that a piece at a time, all the way through life. But if we have faith and we believe, we're totally convinced. Say that with me. Totally convinced. Totally convinced. If we have faith and we believe, we're totally convinced. And if we have, and if we're totally convinced, if we believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, we don't just come to the altar and make a profession. That's part of it. It's a big part of it. But it's giving ourselves. It's cashing that check and getting quarters and going out and giving ourselves to the people that we meet. You see, living for Jesus Christ is glorious. It's glorious. It's the greatest life. Those people over in Afghanistan, they are living the greatest life that can be lived. Oh, they're suffering. They're suffering. And we need to pray for them and do anything we can do to relieve their suffering. That's our part. Amen? To support the missionaries, to support the people there, to do, we've got missionaries that's going over there and rescuing. Praise God, let's support them. But to live for Jesus is the most glorious life that can be. And to give ourselves for Him is a part of that glory. Joseph got two portions. And he's going to continue to be blessed in eternity. And if we've given our life to Jesus, we will receive God's blessings here. And His blessings will go on and on and on, even in eternity. Let's pray.
Our Father, thank You for today. Thank You for this church. Thank You for Your Bible, God's holy word, and all the other things that You give us and do for us. We just, our heart just swells with gratitude for the blessings that You give us. Help us to be totally convinced and never to draw back at serving You and being for Christ and living a holy life for Christ. In Jesus' name, amen. Ask our song leader to come and give us a song of invitation.